Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the Bateman Horne Center Education Meeting. I am Diane Sorensen and on the board of the Bateman Center. And we're so happy that you're all here tonight. Those of you that are here locally and joining us live stream and later on the YouTube channel, so welcome. It's my privilege to introduce my friend, Dr. Lexie Pfeiffer. Daily. She has a new name now because she's a newlywed, which is very exciting. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Lexie Pfeiffer Daly. She has received her specialized training in sand tray work at Gill Institute for Trauma and Recovery. She worked as a resident under Dr. Ileana Gill, renowned for her many books and family play therapy work with traumatized individuals. Dr. Daly graduated with her degree in marriage and family therapy from Brigham Young University. She is currently working in private practice in Holiday, Utah. And I'd like to turn the time over now to Lexie.
Thank you for that introduction. Diane is a really close friend. So today I'm going to talk about chronic illness as it relates to grief, and then how to go through the grief process through sand tray therapy. So one of my favorite books on grieving is Tuesdays with Maury, and he says he had ALS, a chronic illness, and he was dying. And one of the quotes from this book is, when you learn how to die, you learn how to live. And so I think grieving is essential to learning how to live fully. We'll talk more about that. Okay, well, I already got introduced, but I guess, I don't even need to go over this again. That's Dr. Gill right there. We did a play conference a couple Aprils ago, I guess 2 years ago in DC. Something that Diane didn't mention about me, a little personal story, is my mom. My connection to chronic illness or interest in it is that my mom, about, 10, 12 years ago, was diagnosed with Lyme disease. Now, before that, she was struggling with health problems and pain, and they tried to diagnose her with fibromyalgia and other different illnesses, but it was never quite hitting it. And eventually she learned about Lyme disease and she had all the symptoms. It was a big struggle to get treatment because not a lot of doctors validate that it's an actual, well, they don't validate the treatment for Lyme disease is the problem. So one thing that I learned when I was seeing my mom go through all this is that a lot of times chronic illness is not validated. No one says, well, first of all, you have a hard time knowing what's wrong and finding a diagnosis. And second of all, not everyone, even doctors, always validate what's wrong. So that's my connection there. These pictures are from an event in DC they had to try to protest and petition treatment for Lyme disease that she went to. Okay, so how are chronic illness and grief related? There's this concept in the literature on grief called ambiguous loss, and that means it's a loss that is physical or psychological, but it's not concrete or identifiable, so you can't really define it. And people don't send you cards, and they don't mark it with a funeral, like if someone were to really pass away. And so chronic illness is a type of loss because you're losing the things you used to be able to do when your body was fully functioning. You're also losing some of your hopes and dreams that of the things you'd like to have done if you didn't have this illness. And except for not everyone can see what's going on inside your body, and so they don't honor it in the same way that they would another kind of loss. So chronic illness is a type of ambiguous loss that's not validated by others. It's also characterized, it says here, by lack of closure or clear understanding. So, because chronic illness is a loss, it's really important to grieve. And so I'm going to make a case for why it's important to grieve. One of my favorite children's book is called Tear Soup by Pat Schweibert. It's really cute. And it talks about an old lady who had a loss. It doesn't say what kind of loss. And she's making a pot of tear soup, which she has to take time for. She can't just pull soup from a can off the shelf. Because grief is something that takes time and that you have to give attention and energy to. One of my favorite parts of the book is she's telling her grandson that some people didn't tend to their tear soup and it boiled over and it was burnt. And the smell of burnt soup still lingers in these homes. So it's important to pay attention to your feelings and to give yourself time to grieve, because if you don't, those emotions can boil over and they can linger longer than you want them to linger. If you allow yourself to have the emotions, then they may be intense, but you'll go through them instead of having them linger as long. So more reasons that grief is important. Internalizing emotions can be very painful. On the other hand, sharing emotions can be very relieving. Internalizing emotions can create distance in relationships, and sharing them creates connection. And as an example of this, I'm going to show a clip from one of my favorite Disney movies about why it's important to share emotions and to go through grieving together. So this is Frozen, and it's about a 3-minute video clip. I'm going to turn this around. Assume that if we keep our emotions inside that we're protecting other people around us, when actually we end up being in more pain. After this scene, Elsa causes this huge blizzard, and she actually freezes her sister's heart. So the end of the movie is that she learns to love, and it takes away the fear, and Arendelle is no longer covered in a blizzard. So the idea is that if we don't take care of those emotions, they can become out of control. If we share them and we let other people in, then we'll have more help in coping and in dealing with them. I love this quote from The Giver. In The Giver, there's a man that's supposed to hold all the emotions for all of society, so no one else has to feel pain. And he says to his trainee who's going to take his job, the worst part of holding the memories is the pain, is not the pain, it's the loneliness of it. Memories need to be shared. And we can take out memories and we can say grief as well. The worst part of holding it is not the pain, it's the loneliness of it. And when we share it, it is relieving. Okay, so how do you go through grief? Elizabeth Kubler-Ross was the first one to coin the idea of the stages of grief, which are denial, when you say, oh, this isn't really happening to me, I'm not really sick. And then anger, when you're just mad that this is happening to you. Bargaining, I would give anything to not have this. Depression and acceptance. The idea, what happened is people started thinking, oh, this is a stepwise process. After I get through denial and anger and bargaining and depression, I'll be fine and I'll just be able to accept it. But she says that there's no prescribed order for going through these stages, and they were never meant to help tuck messy emotions into neat packages. And actually, we kind of cycle through them, and we go through them in random order again and again and again. And as new things in our life come up, there may be a new thing that we're grieving. And acceptance comes along the way a couple times in little glimpses. So the idea then is to just give yourself permission to go through all the emotions whenever and however long it takes and whenever they come. And to show this, I have another clip from it was a book written by Mitch Albom, but it also got turned into a movie by Oprah. And I have a clip of Maury, who suffered from ALS, talking about how he goes through these stages of grief with his chronic illness.
Thank you.
how well you can see or hear that if you're live, but I'll just summarize a little bit of what happened. Maury kind of goes through all the stages. At first he says he used to be a dancer when he was younger. He loved to dance. He says, I thought if I couldn't dance, I couldn't live. So he says, sometimes I wake up and I think I don't really have ALS. I can do all these things. And that's a little bit of the denial. And then he talks about how angry he gets. What did he do to deserve this? And he talks about waking up and being depressed and crying. And then eventually just detaching from that emotion and thinking of the day ahead, the people that are going to come and visit, and all these other things. And so I really like how that demonstrates that he let himself flow through all those emotions. He didn't judge or try to get rid of any one of them. He just let them all have their place. From the book, Maury says, if you hold back on the emotions, if you don't allow yourself to go all the way through them, you can never get to being detached. You're too busy being afraid. So you can't be afraid of the anger. You can't be afraid of the fantasy and say, oh, pull yourself together. Don't think about that. Let yourself think about the fantasy of if you weren't sick. Let yourself be angry. Let yourself be depressed for however long you need to. You have to let yourself go through those emotions and not be afraid of them to get to the place where you have some sort of inner peace about it. Okay, so SAND therapy is one way of, there's lots of ways to go through grieving, but SAND therapy is one way I help clients to go through their grief. The thing about SAND therapy is you're taking your emotions and you're attaching them to like little figurines and symbols. And so when we think with our cognitive brains, we try to make sense out of things. And that doesn't always connect to our heart and the way we're feeling. So the thing about SAND therapy is it has you connect to your emotions instead of your thoughts about the grief. And so it can shift your emotions instead of just your thoughts. So I'm going to go through these. This is an example, the picture right there of a SAND tray that I did once upon a time. So it's just a little box, there's sand in it, you pick little figurines, you make a world in the sand. You don't always know what the world means or why you're making it, but you just kind of pick the things that mean something to you and you put them together. So I'm going to go through the steps and then we're going to kind of shift with the video camera. The people that are here are going to try it. The people who are at home, you can look at the figurines we have here and you can kind of visualize in your mind which ones you would choose. You can get out a piece of paper even and kind of say, oh, I would put that figure here and put that. So you can kind of draw it out if you want to. We'll try that. So the first thing I want you to do when we come up here is the first step in the process is to connect with the different symbols that are there. So take your time to look at the different figurines and you're going to pick out the ones that pop out to you. Even if they don't seem connected, even if you don't know why they're popping out to you, and even if you have an initial negative reaction to them, like, ooh, I don't like that. But it did stand out to you for some reason. And that's why I have this picture here of sadness. I don't know if you've seen the movie Inside Out. But joy thinks sadness is just annoying because sadness is just going to ruin everything and make Riley, the little girl whose brain these emotions are inside, is just going to make her unhappy and have a bad life. So Joy draws this little circle and says, you stay in there. That's your job. You don't do anything else. So we can't do that to those negative reactions that we have. We can't do that. If it pops out to us, if we have a reaction to it, try not to judge it or isolate it like Joy did to sadness. Then the next step is you're going to arrange them in the sand. If you're at home, you can draw a little box and you can draw where you would put those different figurines. It's not going to be quite the same experience, but it will be close. So the idea here is that you're externalizing those emotions. The emotions are kind of transferred to the figurines and they're not inside of you eating you up anymore. I mean, obviously they're still inside of you, but it's a way of taking all this confusing and painful emotion that's inside and putting it outside of you where you can look at it and manage it and have an experience with it. Other ways of externalizing are to do art or to write in your journal, and those are really good ways of taking yourself through the grief process. The other thing that the theory or philosophy behind this is that these figurines are small and manageable. They're miniatures. So it takes your problem, which seems so big and overwhelming, and it makes it small and manageable and something you can manipulate and look at and develop, make some sort of peace with. And then the last thing about Santre is that it's contained so that it doesn't, because sometimes our emotions, like Elsa's, they feel like they're going to absolutely envelop us and flood us. And so when you're doing the Santre, there's a reason why it's in a contained space, so that all of this emotional stuff that you're working with can be contained in a place where you can look at it and work with it, and it's not as overwhelming. So we're going to practice. So we have some ladies here that are willing to do a little of a demonstration. When we left off, I was letting everyone pick their items and arrange them in their tray. So we'll just pan to each of them and I'll give a little commentary as we go about how these trays can be healing. So, well, hopefully the commentary on that will come from the ladies. So who wants to go first? Right here.
I've been sick for 18 years, and so this was really fun for me to put something together that signifies what I want to be doing when I'm healthy. And I'm doing some of this now, but not on the scale that I'd like to be when I feel good. And first of all, the thing I went to very first was the airplane. And I love to travel, I love to fly. I haven't used my passport for quite some time, and I intend on getting back to doing the traveling I want to. I love to hike. I love rocks. I pack rocks home all the time. And this part is part of what I love, the trees and the woods and the red rock in Utah. I also love to do geocaching with a GPS and go out and do the treasure hunt. And I do a lot of that when I'm able, and sometimes even around town when it's not too hard or taxing. And so that's what the treasure chest is. The snake is just here for fun because I really like snakes and I like to play with snakes. And then the Liberty Bell means liberty to me, to where someday I will be able to have all of the liberty I can. I will be moving beyond my illness and I'll be able to have the liberty I once had.
Thank you. So. I can't remember if this was in the first section, so if I repeat myself, I apologize. There are different kinds of trays that emerge, and this one you've just seen is it's what you want. So sometimes trays will be parallel to maybe some pain you're experiencing or some grief you're experiencing, and sometimes the trays are a way of validating the things you wish for and hope for, and the things that bring you peace. And so this is a really good example of one of those trays that just really focuses on your hopes and dreams and the things that bring you peace. So thank you so much for sharing that. It's really important to give a place for those kind of feelings. So thank you.
Okay, on mine, my daughter has had chronic fatigue syndrome since she was 14 years old. 8 years ago, she came down with it. And I think that this little figurine, I thought just was so sweet and precious looking. And so I think that this represents my daughter. And I think the sand represents the illness and how it is around her. And unlike you with your pretty green snake, this creature here jumped out at me. He's dark. I think he's a cobra, and he just to me looked evil. And I think that he represents my daughter's illness, the chronic fatigue syndrome. I believe this is the illness, the core of the illness. And then this little guy, I knocked him over, and so he jumped out at me. But I think that what he represents is the knight in shining armor that's going to be the cure or treatment or research that's going to help with this illness. So that's my story.
Thank you. I remember when we did this, you saying that you had these figures you didn't quite know, because I prompted them to just pick whatever stands out to them. And she said, I have these figures. I think they're telling a story. I'm not really sure what the story is. And so as she sat down and thought about the story, that's what really took meaning for her. So this is another example. Sometimes Trays will tell a story. They'll talk about a journey. This isn't as much a journey. But the journey through the illness and through grief is in every way a journey. With enemies and heroes and bad times and times when aid comes in, like the knight in shining armor. So that's an example of a story tray and an example of how the trays kind of can take form as you give yourself the space to reflect on what it is you've chosen and what it means to you and the significance it has to you. Thank you.
Okay. My son has chronic fatigue syndrome and has had it for about 3 years, 2 to 3 years. And these figures kind of stood out to me. First of all, we have the wishing well. And I think when he first came down with the symptoms and was first sick, we were looking for the silver bullet. We were putting our wish down the wishing well and hoping for an immediate cure or immediate fix to the problem, and that did not come. And this represents my son as he's fighting this illness, and the trees represent the rest of our family, my husband, myself, and our daughter, who are right there with him, you know, trying to support him and help him along the way. And then there's this hill, and I think right now we're climbing the hill and to try to find a solution, to try and find helps along the way and to help him improve in his condition. And as you go along the path, there are jewels that you come upon, and these jewels are people who help with the problem, people who, you know, Dr. Bateman and other people who support you and who help you. And there are some good things that you learn along the way. And then you just have to keep continuing up that mountain, and hopefully someday we'll be on the downside of the mountain. But there are always things that you can learn, and things that, you know, positive things that come along the way if you stick with it long enough.
Thank you. That is another example of a journey, Trey. The wishing at the beginning, the current situation, and what you're hoping for and anticipating as you look forward, and the little gems along the way. So hopefully, I guess what I'd like to do now is have each of you share how you describe the tray itself. How has the experience itself been valuable to you? The process of choosing something that represents your feelings and taking it outside yourself and putting it in a place where it can be contained and you can kind of take some time reflecting on it. What has that experience been like for you?
I thought when you had all of those objects, I don't know how many hundreds of objects you had out there for us to choose from, and I thought, how you told us just to let them speak to us. And I thought, well, how is that going to be? And then the very first thing I saw was the airplane, and it spoke to me. And the trees spoke to me, and just there were so many things that did speak to me. If you just let your heart and mind just feel, and the things will jump out, just like you said about your warrior. And it was really interesting to hear other people's stories, and the objects that they chose that were perfect for their story. And so it was really helpful to me, not only to do it myself, but to hear the stories of other people, to know that everybody's got their own journey. Everybody's got their own struggles. Being a parent is a whole lot different than being the person with the illness. And you do see it from a lot different perspective. That helped me a lot, seeing just other people's perspective on the illness.
So it was a really bonding experience to see everyone share theirs together and just honor the journey and the experience of each and everyone in the room. I thought that felt really good. What you also described, letting these images speak to you. We feed the mind with books, self-help, and talking through things, and we often don't take the time to feed the emotions, and that's a part you're getting at when you let these images and symbols speak to you. You're giving the heart a place to express itself. So thanks for sharing that.
I agree with that. I think it's interesting to take something concrete and put your emotions into something concrete. It kind of helps define them and kind of helps you, it kind of helped me think through the process we've been through and, you know, and think of what might be to come. And I think it helped to put it in concrete terms. And it really helped me to see other people's, what they chose and their stories, because you can always find similarities and hope from what, from other people's experiences. And so I know it's helpful.
Thank you. You reminded me of something else. I don't know if any of you have seen the movie Life of Pi. There's a scene at the very end. It's this fanciful story about a boy that gets stranded on shipwrecked with a tiger. But before that, there's all these other animals that end up dying until it's him and the tiger. In the end, he gets to shore and these Japanese fishermen are asking him what happened. And he tries to tell them the story about the zebra and the hyena and the tiger, and they don't believe him. And finally, he tells them another story. And in this story, all these people from the ship were shipwrecked, and one killed the other. There was cannibalism. It was really stark and nasty. His mother even died. And in the end, he was so angry at the person who hurt his mother that he killed that person. So it's kind of a confusing shift, because you've watched this whole beautiful story and then you hear this other story that matches the first one, but it's with real people and really horrific kind of events. And he asked the man who's going to write his book, which story do you believe? Or which one do you like? And that man says, I like the one with the tiger. Because both of the stories were true, but one depicted the emotional journey he was going through, and one depicted the actual events that had happened. And so at this point, this man weeps, because it felt so good to be able to validate the emotional journey he had been through. And I think that's what you're saying when you talk about making this emotional journey concrete and being able to honor it and give it a place as well.
Mm-hmm. From my standpoint, I too really enjoyed hearing the other folks talk about what they had chosen. But I think I'll take a little different approach. That it made me realize that what I selected is maybe just a story of hope. And I don't have anything that shows enjoyment or fun in my Santre. It's all about the illness and how bad it is, and we need something to come in and take care of it. And that was really all that I had in my Santre. I didn't have any fun things or any other items in there other than what was centered around the illness.
So sometimes that's part of the process, is noticing that. And then how can I introduce that, or how can I make that more a part of my experience right now? Just noticing something that's absent. So thanks for sharing that. Now everyone doesn't have sand trays and cute little toys, but as I spoke about earlier, any way you honor your journey and the emotions of the journey is really important, whether that's journaling, whether that's artwork. Collages are really nice and they're easy to do. It's kind of the same idea. You take pictures and you put them on a square. That's an easy, cheap way to do something like sand trace. So I hope that you at home can find some way to emotionally validate the experience you're going through and give your heart a chance to talk and to grieve and to rejoice and to hope in ways that you need as you're going through your journey.